You are listening to Concussion 101, a patient's guide to getting ahead again.
Episode 9, My Head Hurts, Part 1. In today's show, your host, Dr. Taher Chugh, Sports MD and Medical Director at York Region Concussion Clinic, will explain different headache types that commonly affect concussion patients and factors that can weigh in on their post-traumatic headache experiences. Enjoy.
Welcome to the 9th episode of this podcast series, Concussion 101. My name is Dr. Maud Boulanger, and I'm a medical doctor at the York Region Concussion Clinic. I'm here today with Dr. Taher Chugh to discuss post-traumatic headaches. So let me start this off by asking you, how common is headache post-concussion?
It's the most common symptom we see post-concussion. Many studies have reported that its incidence is anywhere from 30 to 90%. But in our practice, we see the incidence closer to being at the 90% mark.
And can you mention for us what are the most common types of headaches we see post-concussion?
We most commonly see tension-type headaches and migraines.
Okay, so let's get into these different types of headaches and discuss the diagnostic criteria for headaches. I know that it may seem a bit technical for our listeners, but so many times we have patients come in and say they have migraines. But when you dig deeper and ask more, you find out that they diagnose themselves with migraines just because it hurts a lot. Although other types of headaches can also hurt as much. So can you start off by describing a tension type headache?
So the criteria for episodic tension type headache requires that there are at least 10 episodes of headache and that each headache lasts 30 minutes to 7 days. Can't be associated with nausea or vomiting. I know this is a bit technical, but it's good for people to know. An attention headache patient cannot have both sensitivity to light and sound with the headache. So some will say that they're sensitive to sound and light, then they don't qualify for this diagnosis. The patient can only have one or none. Finally, patients must have at least two of the following features. One, both sides of the head are involved. Two, the quality is like a pressing or tightening sensation. And three, it's not of a very severe intensity. And then some will also say that it's not made worse by physical activity like walking or climbing stairs like migraines are.
Okay, so you said that this was a criteria for episodic tension type headaches. What about for chronic ones?
There is a slight distinction between episodic and chronic tension type headaches, where chronic tension headaches occur on 15 days or more of the month for 3 months in a row. And that patients with chronic headaches may have some mild nausea associated with their headaches.
And what are the criteria for migraines?
To diagnose a migraine without an aura, let's start with that, we require that there be five attacks at least, and that each attack lasts 4 to 72, well, the headache part lasts 4 to 72 hours. That each headache has two of the following features. One, the headache is only on one side of the head. Two, the headache has this pulsating quality. And three, the headache is described as moderately or severely painful. And it's made worse by physical activity, like climbing stairs and so on.
You said that this is for migraine without an aura. Can you discuss what an aura is?
An aura is the second phase of a migraine. So many people think that the migraine is just the headache part, but there's actually four phases to a migraine. So the first phase is called the premonitory phase. The third is the headache. The second is the aura, like I said, and the fourth is the prodrome. About 25% of migraineurs experience an aura. An aura is a neurological symptom that is fully reversible and usually occurs in the context of a headache or a headache following shortly afterwards. Auras can be visual, sensory, they can affect speech or language. They can affect motor control. They can affect functions related to that are governed by the brainstem. They can affect your retina. So depending on the area affected, you'll get different symptoms. The most common auras people get are visual disturbances like shimmering lights.
Okay. Very interesting. Many patients don't realize that the migraine begins before the aura or headache phase. Can you explain what that premonitory phase is?
So there is increased blood flow to certain parts of the brain during this phase. It causes symptoms usually in the 24 hours that precedes the headache. Symptoms that are pretty non-specific, which means like many of us get this all the time at times and we don't really know why. So things like being irritable, being tired, or having neck stiffness, having food cravings, and that gets a little complicated, but some people think that the food cravings will lead to triggering the migraine, whereas sometimes the food cravings are part of this premonitory part of the headache, so it's actually part of the migraine, but that's another topic. Yawning, changes in bowel habits or bladder changes. So if you pick up on any of these signs and you become sensitive to them, you can sometimes avoid an attack with either medical treatment or lifestyle management.
And the postdrome phase, as the name implies, the period of time after the headache.
Right. It can be a day or two after the headache where you no longer have the pain, but you still feel off, maybe sensitive to movement or light or tired, you know, those type of things.
I'd like to go back to auras for a sec. Can you get auras without having a headache?
Yes, you can. There was a study done in Denmark where 38% of their patients reported having both attacks of migraine with aura as well as migraine aura without the headache. And 4% had exclusively migraine aura without a headache. We've had patients with a subtype of migraine known as vestibular migraine. Now, this is an interesting type of migraine, and there are theories about whether the dizziness associated with this is a true aura, biochemically, I mean. But there's one patient that comes to mind. She had dizziness, which was being treated with vestibular therapy. The dizziness was constant at that time. Okay. And she wasn't really responding that well to the vestibular therapy. But we were treating her concussion in a multimodal fashion, as we're kind of outlining in this podcast series. Mm-hmm. And with this quote-unquote concussion, multimodal concussion care, which is also this, there's a lot of overlap between that care and migraine care, her dizziness started to improve. And then it became apparent to us that at times her balance performance was flawless. And she complained of no dizziness at all. So up until this point, she had never reported headaches at all. And once her dizziness was treated as a migraine, her episodic dizziness got a lot better.
Yes, like you said, there's a lot of overlap between headache management and concussion management.
Many think that treating headaches involves mostly medicine. While medicine is an important part for many, it is usually one of a broader treatment plan for headache patients.
I'd like to get more into that, but since you brought up medicine, can you explain what a medication overuse headache is and how often you see it completing the post-concussion picture?
Medication overuse is meant to imply that some headache patients may be using more medication than they should, and this behavior is correlated with continuing headache. Mm-hmm. An example many of us can relate to, perhaps not personally, but is like a glass of wine may relax us. But if you drink wine habitually in amounts considered overusing, it tends to do the opposite. That's to say that it tends to create symptoms of anxiety. And what's the first thing one of these patients will do first thing in the morning to settle their symptoms?
They drink more wine.
Right. So which acutely may help them feel better, but it feeds into this vicious cycle that sees them getting the same withdrawal symptoms.
Okay, so what constitutes overuse?
Medication overuse refers to those patients who have chronic headaches, so on 15 or more days of the month, and also seem to have been regularly overusing medications designed to relieve a headache acutely, and that the headache not be better accounted for another diagnosis. So a specific example would be acetaminophen or ibuprofen or so on. So if you use those more than 15 days of the month, or combination medications like acetaminophen with caffeine and codeine on more than 10 days of the month for at least 3 months, that could be considered overuse.
And many migraine patients use triptan medication to stave off migraines.
Right. So even these, if used on more than 10 days of the month for 3 months straight in chronic headache people, they can be seen as part of the problem. Usually prescribing doctors, though, look out for problematic over-reliance on these medications.
Yeah, I can see how this diagnosis can be controversial. I mean, it's a bit like the chicken and the egg. You have a medication overuse headache, but you can't use a medication to ease it because it may cause or reinforce this headache.
It's not a popular diagnosis amongst patients. In fact, there's some controversy about this diagnosis even amongst professionals. Some feel that medication overuse gets more attention than it deserves and that the evidence that supports its significance is weak. Some say that a more neutral view regarding the role medication overuse plays in patients' headaches should be adopted, and that many patients may unnecessarily blame themselves for perpetuating their headaches when in fact it may not be true.
I think a common ground viewpoint to this dilemma is that headache treatment shouldn't be all about the medication and that there are other good options that could be seen as more fundamental.
Yeah, I agree. For me, I feel that when we suspect medication overuse in patients, it really makes me suspect that they have a disempowering belief about headaches and the effect it has on them.
Interesting. Can you explain that further?
Well, patients who tend to use medications a lot to manage their symptoms firstly have troublesome headaches, obviously. Like, nobody's disputing that. So obviously, they will want to get whatever help they can to manage them. But many of these patients don't realize that there's a lot they can do to help the matter in other ways.
Yeah, rather than resorting to more and more medications.
Right. Often these patients see that external factors are wreaking havoc upon them. What we have noticed is that these patients are more likely to react to their situation with helplessness or fatalism, complaining of the symptom with no plan of action. Looking for that magic treatment or making excuses why they can't do certain things rather than searching for ways on how they can get it done. We hear a lot of patients will say things like, it's killing me. I can't because I'll never. I'm looking for anything. What I would give, I can't because. And, you know, those type of things. As healthcare professionals, whenever we hear it, it kind of strikes us as not helping the problem. So while no one doubts that they're in pain and we empathize with them, we wish we could give them a quick and easy solution. They have to be educated about the nature of pain and healthy ways to think about pain. The focus has to shift from being on illness to being on wellness. Once they can shift their focus, often with cognitive behavioral therapy, we notice that for the majority of our patients, their lot improves.
So you're not saying that negative thinking is causing their headaches?
Not at all. What I'm saying is, despite the controversy that surrounds medication overuse headache, I feel for us in our program, the biggest issue when patients use increasing amounts of medications to manage their headaches is that it heralds a mindset that is focused more on the headache rather than on improving one's lifestyle. I mean, what would you do if I asked you not to think of orange men for the next minute?
I would think of orange men, of course.
Right. And our experience of things that we fear is so much more intense and stifling than things we see more objectively. Our experience of our daily lives will be colored a drabber shade of gray if we just focus on the negative things, even if we can't do anything about them right now. The focus has to shift from illness to wellness so that at least we're helping matters.
This sounds a lot like mindfulness. This came up in a few of our earlier episodes.
Well, more than that, specifically, there are many good psychosocial treatments that will decrease the burden of headaches in and of themselves for most people, and in some will be sufficient to successfully treat headaches. For example, you mentioned mindfulness. Well, a pilot study out of Wake Forest showed promise that mindfulness meditation can help with migraines. They are now doing a follow-up study with more participants to see if they can confirm the findings of the small study.
And many of these treatments are relatively inexpensive in the long run, have low incidence of side effects, and many of our patients can do them right now. What role do behavioral and lifestyle therapies have in headache management?
Behavioral therapy and improving lifestyle is used more for headache prevention. Although some patients have found these strategies help during acute headaches, usually acute headaches are managed with medication. However, if someone is getting many headaches or very long ones or severe ones, then preventing them right off the bat seems more attractive. Unfortunately, a cure for headaches still eludes us, but there are many good tools for managing it. Behavioral techniques are an important and effective, but often overlooked part of headache prevention management schemes.
Yes, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure, as they say. I mean, lifestyle measures like exercise, diet, and weight loss is an important part of the management plan for many medical conditions, in addition to medication. So I feel that makes sense to all of us. How effective is wellness and behavioral therapy for headaches?
There's a lot of studies looking at just this, and it's accepted that the success rate of behavioral and healthy lifestyle measures is about 35 to 55%. That means that although it doesn't cure headaches, it will reduce the frequency or severity or duration of headaches by about one third to one half. That's considered a good result, and is commensurate with the effectiveness of the most commonly used medications for migraine prevention. And it has fewer side effects and many positive secondary gains.
Sure. I mean, if you exercise more, it can help your headaches, but it can also improve your sleep, energy level, weight, and so on.
Also, the gains from behavioral treatments tend to be maintained over time. Some studies have showed that the positive effect of behavioral therapy has persisted even 2 years after their last appointment.
That makes sense. If there's a change in the way I think and act, then in effect, it's a new health culture. You mentioned 2 years from now. Why are long-term changes like this important when the headache was precipitated or exacerbated by a concussion?
Well, a study showed that the incidence of headache 1 year out after sustaining a concussion was about 58%. Now, keep in mind, this is a general statistic, and any one case can be different depending on many different factors. But for many concussion patients, headaches can be a symptom that lingers.
So the statistics are what they are, and we can't afford to dawdle on the things that are under our control. Are there advantages to combining behavioral techniques to traditional pharmacological management?
Studies have found that combining both approaches are complementary, and together they have a better effect than any one strategy alone for migraine. Generally, medications for migraine will usually kick in quicker and seem to help more with the severity of the pain, whereas behavioral strategies seem to help more with the frequency of the pain. And these different effects imply that they're perhaps working by different mechanisms.
So what are some of the reasons why patients would gravitate towards a behavioral approach to headache management?
Some patients can't tolerate the medications used to treat headaches or can't take them because of allergies. The concussion population, for example, seem to be really sensitive to medications on a whole, and for this reason, usually prefer non-medicinal alternatives.
And for some people, they tried medications, but they didn't work.
Or there are patients who have medical conditions that doesn't allow them to use certain medications, or they're pregnant or breastfeeding women who usually prefer to steer clear of medications, that kind of thing.
And I suppose there are some amongst us that have chronic stress that suffer from psychological duress anyways, and figure that it might be a good time to get into behavioral and lifestyle management techniques now, if it will also help with headaches.
Right.
Can you explain how behavioral techniques work in headache patients?
It has to do with the biopsychosocial model of medical illness that we discussed in episode 5. Basically, it's saying that a patient's experience of a headache depends on many other things other than just the pain signal that's transmitted to the brain. In a sense, pain is not just an isolated thing that is the same to all people. It's an experience. Many of us can relate to this. Sometimes a headache hurts more during a stressful period than when we're relaxed.
Yes, I think we can all relate to that.
There was a paper published in 2012 by Dr. Morris Maisels, and his group explored the neurolimbic model of migraine. The limbic system is comprised of a network of structures that is commonly associated with emotions, memories, and the feeling of being rewarded. It outlines how this limbic system plays an active role in how migraines develop and are experienced, which leads into why behavioral approaches to management are effective.
Implying there's utility to exploring improving our emotions, personality styles, thoughts, and behaviors in helping to reduce the burden of headaches or pain in general.
Absolutely.
A lot of patients are thrown off by this. I mean, when they come in and complain of a headache and the doctor recommends a psychologist as part of the treatment plan, many see a headache as a physical condition and can't see how it's related to psychological health. They feel that doctors are implying that they are making up their headaches or that their pain is not real.
I find it helpful to understand where the patient's coming from and then explain how their experience ties into the biopsychosocial model of pain. And then check in frequently with them to make sure they follow what I'm trying to say. Firstly, I think it's useful to explain that we are not recommending psychological or behavioral techniques because they have a psychiatric problem. We're recommending these strategies for headache, and their headaches are real. Headaches are a neurological condition with lots of functional MRI and biochemical studies outlining the way they develop. In this sense, we see quote-unquote real pathology, and you can let them know that. But the behavioral treatments have been helpful to treat headaches, so this is why we're going that way.
Okay. Patients like analogies. Do you have any analogies for that?
So a useful analogy would be acute pain versus chronic pain. So acute pain is useful from an evolutionary perspective. It's what tells us to move our hand out of the fire, for example. Now, what happens when the pain felt from the fire is felt by the patient all the time, even when the hand is nowhere near the fire. What purpose does that serve? What happens? How do we treat that? In a sense, something has hijacked the pain pathways, and it's not the sensory system, as there's no fire to provoke it.
So what is it?
If one looks at functional MRI, we can see that different locations of the brain can be involved in pain perception in different people. For example, the primary sensory cortex and posterior insula in the brain will register the stimulation to the skin. But parts of the brain that deal with cognition, like the prefrontal cortex and the hippocampus, can be involved in pain perception. So thoughts like, oh, I remember the last time I had this pain. It lasted 2 weeks, and I couldn't go to the party that helped my friend get the job she wanted and that I wanted. And now I have a gala this weekend where I have to give a talk, and I'd better be better by then. And what if I'm not? And so on. And then some patients might start ruminating like this on the consequences of their headache. And I mean, who of us hasn't done that before at some level?
Right. So this is why cognitive behavioral therapy or stress management can be helpful for pain, to try to reduce involvement of those different neural networks from firing together.
Yeah. Likewise, emotional parts of the brain, like the anterior insula and the anterior cingulate cortex and the amygdala, can start firing along with the initial sensory stimulation if someone really hates the pain or is afraid of it. And I think we all heard the saying, neural circuits that fire together wire together. This is the same model that underlies any sort of learning. But this process is a double-edged sword and can also work against us. So addressing one's emotional health can also help reduce pain when these emotional regions of the brain get involved.
Okay. In this same train of thoughts, how do you explain the common complaint we get about visual stimulation making patients' headache worse?
We discussed a few neural networks that can participate in the pain experience, but there are others. For example, there are regions of the brain that are involved in integrating sensory stimulation from many different parts of the brain, and also integrating many different neural circuits that are responsible for different themes like emotions and thoughts. Have you heard of the McGurk effect?
Yes, that's pretty interesting. If our listeners are interested, they can go onto YouTube and check it out. Basically, there's a man saying ba, 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 and we hear it as ba, ba, ba. But then they leave the audio the same, but make his lips gesture fa, fa, fa. Et voila, you now hear it as fa, fa, fa.
Yes, and if you close your eyes, you'll hear it again as ba, ba, ba. This is the same principle of neurons that fire together, wire together. So if you expect to hear fa because your eyes see the bottom lip tuck under the top teeth to pronounce the F, your brain can erroneously interpret ba as fa.
Amazing. It makes you wonder what else it is incorrectly interpreting.
So for example, we just explained how pain can get away from us in a maladaptive way. The same can happen in our patients that are sensitive to light or to busy patterns. There is a hyperexcitability of those neurons in areas like the primary visual cortices and lateral geniculate nucleus. That is, they can't tolerate lights as well, and also lights make their headaches worse because it adds more fuel to the fire. In fact, even between headaches, these patients have higher excitability of these neural networks. And it's not just sensitivity to light that has a vicious cycle with migraine. It's a tiring and stressful experience, and is no wonder how its experience can muddle the whole headache picture. In fact, it has been shown that this process that increases sensitivity of the brain can change the structure and function of the brain.
So I know we will be discussing visual issues more with Dr. Ubi in her upcoming episode on vision. And the purpose of this episode today is not so much to discuss the pharmacological management of headaches, but I can see how concussion patients who have headaches will have more challenges than non-concussion headache patients. I mean, concussion patients often have whiplash, disturbances in balance or the way they move, disturbances in the way their binocular visual system functions, which will also be associated with increased light sensitivity, increased disturbances in sleep-wake cycles, changes in psychological and cognitive tendencies, sometimes hormonal changes, changes in the way their autonomic nervous system function, and then we add headaches to that.
Headaches in and of themselves can be a challenging thing to treat. Combining both conditions, headache and concussion, in our experience, requires the treating team to manage it in the way we're outlining in this podcast series. So a multidisciplinary approach for the numerous physical and psychological consequences of concussion with an eye to improving function and wellness.
We'll be producing more episodes on these related topics, but I'd like to continue the discussion on headaches in our next episode by getting more into specific headache treatments, understanding, of course, that many headache treatments will also help other issues affected by concussion and vice versa. I'd like to discuss stress and its role in headache. It has been identified as the number one trigger for headaches, and most of us can relate to this. I would like to discuss methods to manage stress in headache patients and other complementary and integrative medicine approaches that many patients have found helpful. Thank you, Taher, for that informative talk today.
Happy to have been of service.
Thank you for listening to the Concussion 101 podcast. If you enjoyed it, please subscribe to our podcast on iTunes and leave us a review. For more information about concussion-related topics, visit us at www.yorkconcussion.ca. Stay tuned for our next episode.